welcome to worship at Hollywood United Methodist Church. We are glad that you have joined us on this first Sunday in July, both in person and online. Please stand as you're able for our opening hymns.
I want to invite all the children to come and join us on the steps. Won't you come down? Let's step. Come down here. Come down here. We're going to go a little lower. Lila Bell, come on down. Come on. And we have our children's church today for all the kids that are here. Youth group members are welcome to stay in church and worship with your families, or come on up, Cole, or you can come and join us in children's church. All right, so who celebrated the 4th of July? Okay, good, good showing of you. And so what did you do to celebrate? What was something that you did? Oh, okay, sorry, that's a secret. Cool, I like that, thank you.
We played card games with our neighbors.
I love playing games.
I flew to Chicago, and then I had to drive all the way up to Wisconsin, and then we went to a fair with my cousins and played some games.
Wow, a road trip and cousins.
I went to see the Pride Parade, so I got lots of candy.
To a pride parade, that's lots of candy. All right, that's awesome.
I saw the Six Flags Magic Mountain fireworks show.
Okay, that's wow. Y'all know how to party. That's amazing. Why do we even celebrate the 4th of July? Does anybody know? Like, what are we celebrating? Yeah.
America.
America. Usually the answer is Jesus, but right now it's America in this question. That's good.
We celebrated it because that was the day we decided, and we don't want to be part of, what's that country called again? I forgot.
England.
England.
That's right. That's right. That was where the country decided we wanted to be free. We wanted to be our own country and not be under the rulers from England. And so we celebrate independence. We celebrate that we, a lot of people fought and a lot of people died so that we could be our own country and we could be free. Do you know that church, coming to church on Sunday is a little bit like a 4th of July party? How do you think that is? How is church, coming to church, like going to a 4th of July party?
Because Jesus is also part of America.
Yes, Jesus is in America and in every country of the world, absolutely.
I guess it's because you're still hanging out with friends and family.
Yeah. We're here to be with our friends and family, much like we do on the 4th of July when we have that party. But also, we're celebrating our freedom. We're celebrating the freedom that we get, that Jesus has brought to every single one of us. There is nothing that separates us from God's love, and that is something to celebrate. And sometimes we forget that. So luckily, every single Sunday, we can come here to church or watch online and be reminded that we have God's love. We are free in Christ, and nothing will separate us from God's love. So we're having our Church Independence Day celebration today, and I'm glad that you all are here to join us. Let's pray, and then we will go off to Children's Church. Okay. Creator God, we thank you for the freedom that you have brought us. We are not bound by the things that we do wrong. We are not forever guilty when we hurt someone or hurt ourselves or make a mistake. We are forgiven, we are loved, we are washed clean every single day by your love, Jesus, for us. May each time we come to church and wherever we are, be reminded of your love for us and that nothing separates us. When we might feel like there's a huge gap between where we are and where you are, God, please, by your Spirit, remind us. You are right there, you're near, you love us, you're guiding us, and you're with us. We pray a blessing on all these children here, on all the ones that aren't here today, the ones that are home. Thank you for them. Thank you for their wonderful spirits of joy and love and kindness. May they lead us into being children of yours, and may we lead them to always be looking after you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, as we head off to Children's Church, I invite you all to stand and pass God's peace to one another.
Peace be with you. Oh, let's try it again. Peace be with you. I know you already did before, but let's turn around and give it to the balcony and all our friends and family watching from home. Peace be with you. We love you, and we're so grateful you've joined us online. I invite you to take your seats. Get out your fans. Find a fan. If anybody's wondering about a good pastoral summer gift, all of us could use a beautiful church fan up here. Take a deep breath. I invite you to still your mind and your heart and to open yourself to the still small voice of God as we enter into this beautiful time of prayer together, led there by our chancel choir. Holy One, we gather here in your house, seeking your strength, desiring your wisdom, leaning into your blessing. Thank you for the multitude of blessings you have brought into our lives, for those we acknowledge with each day that are so easy to recognize, and for the small ways you move and act within and around us that we often fail to see. You are always here, guiding, nudging, waiting, compelling us forward in this journey of faith and becoming. And for this, we offer our deepest thanks. On this weekend, after this nation has celebrated its independence, keep us mindful of the work that is required to keep democracy and to grow our freedoms. Give us voice to speak when we see the rights of women being eroded. Give us strength to struggle in the face of a rising tide of anti-LGBTQ legislation. Give us courage to resist ever louder racist and anti-immigrant sentiment and politics in this country. Make us vigilant against the rise of fascism and Christian nationalism. Give us the awareness to understand that some still struggle to be free in the land of the free. And dear Lord, do the work of making us co-conspirators in your holy work of liberation. Holy One, bless us this morning as we welcome into our family our new senior co-pastor, Reverend Hannah. Fill her with your spirit and surround her with your strength and love as she begins this new phase in her pastoral journey. Give her wisdom and creativity and bring her joy as she begins her new work with us. Accompany our team of pastors, lay leaders, and our congregation as we serve together to create and do a new thing in the ongoing work of building the beloved community. Bring your healing presence to all those in our community who are struggling today. Bring healing to Pat and remember Andy. As the summer heat increases, we pray for shelter and adequate resources for our unhoused neighbors. Bring strength and inspiration to Leo as he too begins a new thing. We thank you for Sinead's successful surgery and ask you to bring her rapid healing. Bring solace to Lynn on the passing of her mother, healing for Steve and for Mark and for Brendan on the loss of their father, and healing for Billy as he recovers. We pray for recovery from surgery for Chris as well. And we ask that you give courage to the workers at the West in Long Beach who have begun their second day of strike, the first in a season of labor, change, and challenge. There are so many prayers on our hearts. We're especially grateful for the witness of those who remember that this is Disability Awareness Month. And we pray that throughout this month you awaken us to the power, strength, and gifts of our brothers and sisters and siblings in the disability community and all that they bring not only to our faith community but to our larger world. We have many prayers that remain on our hearts and mind, and we offer them now to you in a moment of silent prayer. Receive these prayers that we have offered. We thank you, knowing that you can carry all. We bring them to you humble with our deepest love and devotion. And we pray that you will continue to move in our lives. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hello, friends. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hebrews 13, verses 7 and 8, as Eugene Peterson translates it in his Message paraphrase of the Bible, says, appreciate your pastoral leaders who gave you the word of God. Take a good look at the way they live and let their faithfulness instruct you as well as their truthfulness. Hello, Hollywood. I'm Dr. Larry Hyde, Jr., Chair of your Governance Board, and I'm here this morning with my Governance Board colleague, my dear sister, Sarah Thurman Corling, who chairs our Staff Parish Relations Committee. We are here this morning to welcome our new co-senior pastor and welcome back our returning pastors. We are United Methodists, and in the United Methodist system, the bishop appoints and sends pastors each year to lead local congregations. This is called the itinerant system. These appointments take place every single year, with the appointment year running from July 1st to June 30th. All United Methodist clergy are appointed to this system from July 1st to June 30th. The bishop who makes appointments for our church is Bishop Dottie Escobedo Frank. Bishop Dottie was here back in December for the AIDS ribbon celebration, and she leads the 350 congregations with 50,000 United Methodists in Southern California, Hawaii, Guam, and Saipan. I could say Happy New Year this morning, because churches across the United States, United Methodist churches across the United States, are welcoming new pastors and returning pastors for the next appointment year. We are blessed this morning. We are blessed this morning to open our arms wide and welcome a new co-senior pastor to our Hollywood Harmony Toluca Lake family and welcome back three returning pastors.
It is with great joy this morning that we welcome our new co-senior pastor, the Reverend Hannah Adair Bonner, to our Hollywood Harmony Toluca Lake family. You want to join me in giving her a warm welcome of applause? We will tell you more about Rev Hannah in a moment, and you'll get to hear from her this morning as she delivers the sermon. This morning, we also welcome back our co-senior pastor, the Reverend Kathy Cooper Ledesma, beginning her 19th year with us at Hollywood UMC. For the next appointment year, Rev Hannah and Rev Kathy will co-senior pastor both campuses. There are two other pastoral appointments that Bishop Dottie has made for the next appointment year as well. Pastor Bridie Roberts, who is a licensed local pastor, will return as our associate pastor. Pastor Bridie is also appointed as an organizer with Unite Here Local 11. Let's give her a round of applause, too. And last but not least, we also welcome back Pastor Mark Stevenson, who will continue to lead our Harmony Toluca Lake campus. He is a layperson assigned to the congregation. We are grateful for all that our pastors have done and will continue to do.
At this time, we want to introduce you to our new co-senior pastor, the Reverend Hannah Adair Bonner. Over the past few weeks, as she has transitioned to Southern California, several of us have gotten to break bread, march in two pride parades, and get to know her. She is a proudly and publicly queer clergywoman in the United Methodist Church. Rev. Hannah comes to us having served as the executive director of the Campus Christian Center at the University of Arizona, the director of the Wesley Foundation of Tucson, affectionately known as Frontera Wesley, and the president of the University Religious Council at the University of Arizona. This is a position she held since 2017. In that work, she invested deeply in creating safe and just spaces for LGBTQ people and the undocumented community, and was recognized repeatedly as Staff Supporter of the Year by the African American Student Association. Outside of her work, her life was focused on humanitarian efforts and activism to ease the suffering experienced by immigrants and indigenous communities in our border region.
From 2014 to 2016, Rev. Hannah served in the heart of downtown Houston as an associate pastor for St. John's UMC, which has 9,000 members. And she initiated new ministries in the greater Houston community for young adults, living out the church's DNA to eliminate racism, sexism, and classism from the worship experience and engaging a new generation. Her primary work was giving birth to The Shout, a community of poets, activists, actors, and filmmakers utilizing the arts to bring scripture to life and put faith into action. In 2015, Rev. Hannah sat outside the jail in Waller County, Texas for 80 days to demand justice for the false arrest and unexplained death of Sandra Bland. In 2018, HBO released the documentary Say Her Name, The Life and Death of Sandra Bland, which included interviews with Rev. Hannah and featured her footage extensively.
From 2011 to 2013, Rev. Hannah served our entire 12 million member denomination as the Northeastern Jurisdictional Regional Staff for the General Board of Discipleship. In this capacity, she supported, resourced, and coordinated communication and collaboration among United Methodist ministries to youth and young adults, clergy, and laity in 10 annual conferences, 10 regions of the Northeastern United States, while collaborating with other coordinators all around our global church. During this time, she was chosen to serve as the young adult representative from the United Methodist Church to Churches Uniting in Christ, which is a coalition founded to help denominations work together to eliminate racism in their churches. In this role, she served with our own Bishop Mary Ann Swenson, who was the ecumenical officer for the Council of Bishops at that time. She has been a keynote speaker for the United Women in Faith Global Assembly and has had her expertise sought to write solidarity and anti-racism resources for the General Commission on Religion and Race. Reverend Hannah has also been a pastor at Asbury Temple UMC in Durham, North Carolina, and Grace UMC in the Peninsula Delaware Conference. She earned a Master's of Divinity from Duke Divinity School and a Bachelor of Science in Psychology from Furman University. In 2016, she became an honorary member of Sigma Gamma Rho Sorority, Incorporated, which is one of our Divine Nine, our traditionally Black African-American sororities and fraternities.
Just a little bit to go. We have a lot to catch up on 2 decades of ministry. Also in 2016, Abingdon published Rev. Hannah's first book, The Shout, Finding the Prophetic Voice in Unexpected Places. It was a Bible study curriculum arising out of the community she had built as the curator of The Shout, a spoken word poetry-focused artivism movement seeking to nurture a community of multi-ethnic, multi-generational, justice-seeking, solidarity-building people in Houston. Rev. Hannah was front and center at the United Methodist Church's recent general conference in Charlotte, working as the communications director for the Queer Delegate Caucus. The Queer Delegate Caucus helped to get the harmful and restrictive LGBTQ language removed from our book of discipline. Mm. Rev Hannah had the following reflection on her ministry, quote, "I began my career as a pastor at the historic Asbury Temple UMC, where students began doing sit-ins a few years before the movement took off in Greensboro. I have worked at large flagship congregations, Grace UMC, the flagship church of the Peninsula Delaware Conference, and St. John's in the Texas Annual Conference. But I'm most proud of the work I did at Hope AME, outside the gates of Prairie View A&M University, where I celebrated communion each Sunday after Pastor Sean Nickelberry preached. In my over 20 years of ministry and 15 years of pastoral ministry, I have been known above all else for my integrity, consistency, and courage. Therefore, I have been both a frustration to the institution of United Methodism and also a source of pride to them. The best introduction I have ever received was when I walked into a planning meeting for the World Methodist Conference, and one of my former colleagues from my time working at the General Board of Discipleship introduced me with only these words, 'This is Hannah Adair Bonner, and God has a hand of protection over her life. This I trust, whatever comes, for God has proven it again and again.'"
My friends, these are only a few highlights of Rev. Hannah's ministry. As you can see, Rev. Hannah has been sent to us for such a time as this in the life of not only our congregation, but our entire United Methodist denomination. We are excited about the energy and the leadership that she will bring as we move forward as a congregation on both campuses into God's faithful future. Rev. Hannah, we have a small gift to welcome you. We hope that when you open this bag later on, we have some Sigma Gamma Rho swag for you. And every time you use your Sigma Gamma Rho swag, we hope that you will think of us.
We invite you to drop a note of welcome and introduction to Rev. Hannah. Her email is revhannah@hollywoodumc.org. Please join the governance board after worship in the gym for cake and fellowship as we welcome Rev. Hannah to the HUMC family and welcome back our returning pastors and staff for this appointment year. We have asked our pastor emeritus, Reverend Dr. Ed Hansen, to give us a few words and pray for our pastoral staff and congregation. Rev. Ed.
Friends, let's be in prayer. Oh God, we are blessed. We give thanks for those you have called to be with us as our co-senior pastors, our associates and staff, and pray that your Spirit will be powerfully present with them to lead, to comfort, to challenge, to give hope, and to inspire us to yet greater expressions of loving community. Sustain and strengthen these your servants in their ministries and work among us. Broaden and deepen their wisdom and insights as they call us to work for justice, for peace, love, understanding, and reconciliation in our world. We pray especially for our co-senior pastors, our newly appointed Reverend Hannah Adair Bonner, and our longtime pastor, Reverend Kathy Cooper Ledesma. May their work among us and their faithfulness to your call strengthen this community of faith and be a source of joy for all who come here for a spiritual home. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
All right. Happy Sunday morning, church family. Have a good holiday weekend. Did you enjoy some fireworks, maybe? My favorite is enjoying them until 4 o'clock in the morning while I'm trying to sleep. It's good to see you all here today. So a couple announcements before we get going. If you would, let's go ahead and check in. This is the time where we ask you to get out your phone, scan that QR code, drop your name in there. If you aren't on the email list, you can always put your email in there. And more importantly, if you have a prayer request, there's an area to put in there, prayers, and we get those every week, and the pastoral team prays over them. So please share those with us as you're able. Also, if this is your first time, I just want to say a special welcome and thank you for sharing your morning with us. My name's Devin, and if you come to the gym afterwards, there'll be cake, I hear. Come to the gym afterwards, see me at the welcome table. I have a little welcome bag for you that I'd like to give you, so come see me afterwards. A couple things to just keep on your radar as we're going through the next couple of weeks. First of all, we have the Hawkins Grant that is back this year for the first time in, I think, since 2019. But this is a grant that is awarded by the team, Hawkins Grant team, for any member that is of Hollywood or Harmony. And it is really financial assistance for continuing education. So there's applications online if you scan that QR code. I have a couple printed off, too, if you just want to read over them, but at the welcome table. But come see me after church if you'd like to know more information on that. A couple things coming up next week. Next week is a movie night, and we're going to go see the 8-year-old in me is excited. We're going to go see the Minions movie, part 4. That's going to be at the Universal AMC at 6:15. So I have more information on that if that interests you. On Tuesday, half price. By the way, they're half price movie ticket nights. So it's a good time to go see a film. Also, speaking of movies, starting next Sunday is Crossflix. And we're going to start with the documentary film, The Last Repair Shop, which is a great film and won an Academy Award. So join us next Sunday for that as well. And then also after church on the 14th, there's a couple more spots open. So if you're interested, you can sign up. But we'd love to have you come volunteer at Project Angel Food. We're going over to their kitchen on Vine Street at 1 o'clock. It's just a couple hours after church. But we're going to prepare about 3,000 meals for seriously ill individuals that are homebound. So we'd love to have you participate if you have the time next Sunday afternoon. Then one last thing, of course, Rev Jefferson on the 21st is going to come over and share with us his talents of sound bath and meditation and worship. We're going to do that in the chapel, air-conditioned chapel, by the way. You can bring a yoga mat, a blanket, or just lay on the carpet. But it's a wonderful time to reflect, to center yourself for the week. And it's about a 30-40 minute worship session. So that is after church on the 21st. And of course, today, please join us afterwards in the air-conditioned gym, Back to the Future gym, by the way. We're going to have a wonderful time to celebrate Rev Hanna. We've got some cake. I hear there might be some presents for people. I'm not sure what's happening. But we have a nice reception afterwards. And you can take these stairs right over here on the left-hand side and go straight up. It's about 20 stairs, or you can go around the courtyard. But we'd love to have everybody come and participate after church. A lot of things going on, obviously, in the life of this church. And grab one of these event flyers if you haven't already. A couple more months to go on here, but we have a lot of things coming up. We'd love to have you be a part of it. Because everything we do here happens because of you. Through your prayers, your presence, your volunteering and your service, and also your gifts. So as the ushers come forward and we put up a QR code for online giving, please give as you're able so we can continue to grow this ministry here in the heart of Hollywood. Thank you for being with us today. Thank you.
Friends, our scripture reading is from 1 John. This is a small little book toward the end of the Bible. It's one of my favorites, so look it up sometime. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 21. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent God's only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent God's Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and God's love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in God and God in us, because God has given us of God's Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent God's Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as God is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because God first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate a sibling are liars. For those who do not love a sibling whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from God is this: those who love God must love their siblings also. May God bless this reading to our hearing and understanding. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Hollywood family. I'm so glad to be with you. I've already been told where to get the good tortillas, and so I'm excited to learn that and so many other things from all of you. I'm excited to be on this journey with you. I want to share with you that I have family in the house. You know, my birth family is back on the East Coast, but I have chosen family that's traveled from Arizona, Evan and Sanan and Maddie, who is here actually at UCLA. In the research department, and so I hope that you'll make them feel welcome. And also, if you read my email from the pastor this week, then you know what an amazing person Rosa Manriquez is, and what a gift she is to our city of LA, and so I'm very honored that she is here as well, and I hope that you'll take the opportunity to get to meet her as well. When I was beginning seminary 20 years ago, I sat down on a park bench next to a man named Dempsey Calhoun. I told him that I had just moved to Durham, North Carolina to start seminary at Duke Divinity School. And he told me that he was a retired pastor himself. He made me promise to do something that day. He said, there's enough things in the world to make people scared. They should not go to church and find fear there. Give them hope, he said. Promise me you'll give them hope. Let us pray. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Usually, during this first week of July, you can find me out in Waller County, Texas, which is a rural area partway between Houston and Austin, at Hope African Methodist Episcopal Church, outside the gates of Prairie View A&M University, an HBCU, historically black university, with a rich history of preparing generations of amazing leaders. My community and I have made the pilgrimage back there year after year because that church is the place where a young black woman named Sandra Bland was falsely arrested, the 9th anniversary this coming Thursday, and died there in custody. The year was 2015, the same summer that the shooting happened at Mother Emanuel in Charleston, South Carolina. The same summer that Bree Newsom climbed a flagpole to take down the Confederate flag. It was a summer full of courageous love as people refused to let fear control them anymore. Several months earlier, in January of 2015, Sandra Bland had been in Chicago, where she was from, when she made the choice to answer the call of God by using videos called Sandy Speaks to educate people and encourage them to put their faith into action.
It's time, y'all. It's time. It's this thing that I'm holding in my hand, this telephone, this camera, it is quite powerful. Social media is powerful. We can do something with this. If we want to change, we can really, truly make it happen. You know, we sit out here and talk about, oh, we need the next so-and-so and this and that. No, you don't. No, you don't. Start in your own home. Start with you. You start being that person to want to make that change. So it's funny. I might, whoever is watching this, you might hear I'm probably going to get a few of the Michael Jackson, oh, I want to make that change comment. But laugh all you want to. Say what you want. But I'm here to change history. I am ready to do what I need to do for this next generation. It's time. It's time for me to do it's time for me to do God's work at the end of the day. Because he and I know everybody don't believe in God, which is fine. But I want you to know on Sandy Speaks, I'm gonna talk about God because for me, he has truly opened my eyes and shown me that there's something out there that we can do. We can stop sitting around and just saying, oh, well, maybe next time. Or, oh, well, we knew that was going to happen. It's time to stop knowing that that was going to happen. And it's time to start doing something.
It's time to start doing something. At the time of Sandra's death, I was serving as pastor of The Shout, a community of poets, actors, filmmakers, dancers, singers, and activists in Houston, Texas, many of whom knew and loved Sandra. With their support and their encouragement, I would spend the majority of the next couple years of my life in Waller County, Texas, supporting the students of Prairie View A&M University, where she was arrested, and collaborating with Pastor Sean Nickelberry and Mother Ruth Ella Perkins Jackson, at Hope AME, the scene of her arrest, and trying to live out my belief that the power that fear has on communities can be broken. The first 80 days after Sandra's death, I would spend in the Texas sun, in front of the jail where she died, sitting in prayerful vigil, ensuring that her call would not be silenced, that people would continue to hear her voice, and asking the question, what happened to Sandra Bland? During that time, men all around that county and the country sent me messages about how they would like to be a part of seeing my own call and life end. In the year that followed, as the work continued in other ways, a documentarian asked me how that time felt.
Which then prompted a retired prison guard from this area to post a viral video on YouTube challenging people here in Waller County to come and kill us. And so he said he was going to show up with the guns, and he wanted everybody to get involved. He wanted, you know, the children and the women and the elderly to bring slingshots and stones and to rout us from the jail, and then the men would finish us off when we ran with their guns, and it was ridiculous. But I had a choice of what to do, and so I went back to the Waller County Jail, knowing all of the context of what was going on. That was the choice. I had not been released from my task. And so I went back to the jail and took up my position again at the jail and relieved the folks that were there. And
what were you thinking when you were driving there from the airport or from wherever you were coming from?
I think that throughout that moment and many other moments, I had a deep sense of peace, because of course it's frightening. You don't know what's going to happen. But I knew that I was where I was supposed to be and doing what I was supposed to be doing. And so for me, there's not really any other option. If you know where you're supposed to be and what you're supposed to be doing and you don't do it, then it's not really living. And so why protect a life not lived, right? And so if I know I'm supposed to be there, it doesn't matter what the consequences are for being there. I have to be where I'm supposed to be and do what I'm supposed to do. Because that is what it is to live. So I went back, not because I wanted to die, but because I wanted to live.
Many people told me that they didn't think I was going to survive, and the weight of that got heavier and heavier every day. People around the country were praying for me. And I know some are in this room. As I got up each morning to head to the jail, it got harder and harder to get out of bed, knowing what I was facing. But it was these words that got me up each morning that Reverend Dr. Ed read from 1 John 4. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear. Because we did get up, and we kept showing up, things did change. We didn't destroy white supremacy in rural Texas, but we loosened the stranglehold of fear that it had over people by refusing to let fear have the final word. It wouldn't have been brave if we weren't scared. It doesn't take courage if you're not afraid. Yet when we refuse to let fear control us, when we refuse to let it have the final word, something changes in the world. Each person who chooses love instead of fear makes the power of fear a little weaker. Person by person, day by day, home by home, vote by vote, choice by choice, action by action, every day we have a choice. Fear or love. This is why God's messengers, the angels, always announce their arrival with these words. Fear not. To the prophet Isaiah, fear not. To Mary, the mother of Jesus, fear not. To the shepherds keeping watch in the fields, fear not. To the women at the tomb when Jesus is resurrected. When God shows up, when God interrupts our days, our plans, our expectations, it can be a little overwhelming. And even if God's plans for us are good, full of love, and as Jeremiah says, plans to give you a future with hope, even when the adventures that God calls us into are good, when they are unexpected or they're different from our own plans, it can still be a little scary. It can make us a little anxious, a little uncertain, a little uncomfortable. So before the angels give their messages, they always say, fear not. Knowing that we humans have a tendency to do so. And God knows that about us. God cares about our feelings. God expresses concern for our feelings with those soothing words. Fear not. You don't have anything to be afraid of. Trust me. God invites us. Here, in the city of angels, what fears have you been carrying this week? Are you afraid that things will change too much or not enough? Are you afraid of all the rulings that are coming from the court of our land that make us nervous about women's bodily autonomy, about our school system, our undocumented neighbors, the safety of our trans children and adults, the rights of gay people like me to get married? Or maybe your fears are a little more personal. Maybe you're afraid to really let your friends or parts of your family really see all of you. Maybe you're afraid to bring all of you before God. Afraid to let all of you be seen and all of you be loved. No matter how many times we hear these words, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them, it can still be hard when the ways that people who say that they're acting in God's name have treated us don't feel like love. This past week, when I was out in West Hollywood with Kevin and the Heavens and Hannah, promoting Hollywood UMC, someone came by and told us that they didn't want to be LGBTQ anymore, that they wanted to be with God instead. I pulled out my best stuff, the stuff I've been working on for decades. The stuff that has helped countless LGBTQ folks come along. The stuff that I've had to wrestle with myself. Work that I know follows in the legacy of people like Reverend Dr. Ed Hansen, Reverend Dr. Denise Barnes, and others who are queer or gay and have served this congregation, who first had to conquer our own questions about our own gayness before we could help others do likewise. So I brought all of this to the conversation with this person. We were talking about translation and the Ethiopian eunuch and what Paul really meant. But at the end of the day, as I'm sure some of you have experienced yourselves when you invite friends to church, this person just wasn't ready. Healing takes time, and it takes love. Deep, unconditional love. I get that. I grew up as a girl who had zero interest in Tiger Beat magazine. Where are my millennial and Gen X women? Zero interest in Tiger Beat magazine, Jonathan Taylor Thomas, JTT. Or really talking about boys at all. I was fighting everything about who I was and who I was called to be. And I don't really talk about my childhood much, but I know that there are some people in this room who know what I'm talking about. People who know what it feels like to have the people who are supposed to love us make us feel that they can only love a part of us, a piece of us, but not all of us the way that God does. I know that there's people in this room who know what it feels like for the places where we should feel safe and welcome to make us feel like we don't belong. I read verses like this one from the passage today. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. And I slowly, as a child, began to wonder why the people who controlled what we thought and what we taught about God didn't really seem to know much about God, or what God really said, or what God really did. But just because people have used God's name in vain, and maybe they need to study the Ten Commandments themselves a little bit before they force us to put them up in the classrooms. Just because they have used the Lord's name in vain to make people feel fear and hate in God's name, that does not mean that that is who God is. They do not get to control that. Something that I want you to know about me is that I believe, if you can't tell, in facing what we fear. Talking about it directly. Dealing with it openly. Together. So that it loses its power. So that you don't feel alone with it. So that we can turn the daggers that people try to use into butter knives. So that no matter how much someone jabs it at you, it just can't really hurt you anymore. It can't hurt me anymore. And I want that for all of my LGBTQ kin. The ones who will never darken the doors of the church, and the ones who have not yet found a church like Hollywood UMC, or a pastor like Rev Kathy, and who sit in the pews of churches that make them feel like they have to hide. When I was in the trenches working to confront white supremacy in rural Texas, I did not feel like it would be safe to be public about the fact that I was gay. Any guesses as to why? I was living in safe houses, using burner phones and disguises, and using every bit of power that I could leverage in this world to try to keep the people around me safe. Sandra Bland had summoned a certain kind of courage from me, but when I left Texas, it was time to confront another kind of fear. I knew full well what could happen to me for being a publicly queer clergywoman. I was ordained in eastern Pennsylvania, where Frank Schaefer was defrocked, the conference that defrocked Beth Stroud, who Pastor Bridie shared with us about last week. And all of this had left my conference feeling like there was a big gaping hole in the center of our chest. No one had come out publicly since Beth. But she had done something for me that I wanted to be able to do for others. She had loved herself, and she had loved us as her LGBTQ kin enough to say publicly, God loves us, and there's nothing to be ashamed of. God loves every piece of us, the wholeness of who we are. So when I left Texas, I joined the ranks of those publicly gay clergy who were forcing the United Methodist denomination, to reckon with the power of that love that Beth had modeled, that love that overcomes fear, that love that renders fear powerless to control us, the love that says, I choose life, I choose to live this life wholly, fully, and fear begins to lose. Day by day, person by person, vote by vote, choice by choice. Last month, after working with the Queer Delegate Caucus at General Conference and getting to be in the room as the delegates from around the world completely eradicated all anti-LGBTQ language from our policies and our principles, I flew back to the East Coast, and I have kept my membership in that conference no matter where I've lived, so that somewhere in the world they still have a gay clergy person. I flew back to the Eastern Pennsylvania Annual Conference to get to cast my vote to reinstate Dr. Beth Stroud as Reverend Dr. Beth Stroud. I got to be there as she placed the red stole back on her own shoulders, because it had been rightfully hers all along. It was the best day of my life. To me, it felt like resurrection.
Are you ready?
Uh-huh. And fear loses. Fear loses. Person by person, day by day, choice by choice, step by step, each time that we choose love instead. Now, I don't mean to spoil the ending, but no matter how things might feel in this nation right now, God's already told us how this ends. God's already told us that love does, in fact, win. The question that I want to leave you with today is, what are you willing to do? What are you willing to do to help love win over fear? This week, this month, this year, how will you say to fear, you don't make the decisions anymore? Amen.
on the night in which he was betrayed that Jesus gathered his disciples in the upper room. And there he took bread, and he gave thanks to God, and he broke the bread and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take it, eat all of you, for this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and he gave thanks to God, and he gave it to the disciples and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you will in remembrance of me."
Let us pray. Holy Lord, loving God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ that goes forth to heal and defy fear. Now let us pray together the words that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This bread has gluten. There is a gluten-free option, which the ushers will bring forward for you. We serve by intinction. The cup is grape juice. You may receive a piece of the bread and then dip it in the cup. If you would rather have your own personal serving, those are available also on the table that is being placed now. In the United Methodist Church, the table of the Lord is open to everyone who wishes to receive. You do not need to be a member of this church or of any church. You simply have to have the desire to partake. The table is set, and we are all invited.
Thank you.
Well, my friends, we are off on our adventure. I can't wait to see what the future holds as we are on this together. Can we give thanks for our amazing choir and our amazing leader, John West? And so grateful to all of our staff who've made me feel so welcome, to our amazing folks up in the balcony, to our facility techs, to our pastoral staff, to everyone who has made this such an amazing place, our ushers, to all of you who have made this such a special day, we give thanks. If you would like to join for a reception after the service, I would like to meet you. I would love that as we start going somewhere together. It's hard to figure out where you're going when you don't know who you're traveling with. So please join us for a reception after the service. If you'd like to use the stairs, you can go out this door. If you'd prefer to use the ramp, you can go out the back door and through the courtyard and find us back in the gym. So looking forward to that. Receive this blessing. Go forth knowing that you are not alone. Go forth choosing love over fear and remembering how little power fear actually has in comparison to the God of all might and all glory, who loves you wholly and completely and unconditionally, every single inch and part of your body, mind, and spirit. Go forth to love and to serve the world. Amen.